My name is Warren Louw, and I am a freelance illustrator for the entertainment industry, primarily for the comic and gaming industry. Okay, and before I go in any further, how many of you here are artists? Raise your hand. All right, yeah, okay, that's good to see. All right, okay, cool. So I'm going to be sharing quite a bit with you guys, and chances are you're probably not going to remember half of it. So if you guys do ever get in a spot where you do need advice, whatever, I am willing to help you out. You're welcome to just message me on my Facebook page, Art Warren Louw, and whenever I have the time, I'll make sure to respond to you. All right, so to get into things, becoming an artist, that I'm going to be talking about becoming an artist and then dealing with the industry. Okay, so as I'm sure all of you know, being an artist is not an easy thing at all. You are going to be dealing with a lot of your demons, a lot of your insecurities are going to be really coming out. And I know that's something I dealt with for quite a lot of my life. Hey, even the past couple of years, you wouldn't think so, but even at this stage at my level, I still have a hard time with certain areas of my own skill and my own successes as an artist, as being overly hard on myself as artists like to do. Alright, so how did I actually get past that? And basically, those kind of struggles are something that's kind of always going to be around to an extent, so you've got to find a way of actually working with them. Alright, so what I found that is a very common theme with many artists is that we tend to compare ourselves a lot. We see these other artists out there internationally, and we compare ourselves, and we really are just far too hard on ourselves to the point where we strip ourselves of our self-worth as artists, and we basically get to a point where we consider giving up. Alright, and I'm sure most of us have been through these testing times. Alright, so just know that that is a part of this process, and these are vital elements that can help you basically move forward as an artist. So basically, when it comes to dealing with the problems of comparing ourselves and all that, why we do this? Okay, like in the beginning, from a young age, we really love art. You know, it's a fun experience and all that. But then it gets to a point where we get taught to compare ourselves because, you know, so-and-so gets put on a pedestal as being the superior artist, and then we compare ourselves, there's no way we can compare ourselves because there's such a huge gap. Alright, so basically, in the beginning, we are centered. We are very centered within ourselves in that love and in that passion for art. And over time, we lose that passion and we get lost in our struggles, which I did for quite a few years. So the best way to honestly really center yourself is to basically withdraw from everything, from all the attention that you were giving to the outside world, art community, everything that kind of triggered you in the wrong direction with your art, and just focus on doing art for yourself. Do what you love. Just for you, because I find a lot of artists, what they will do is they will focus on creating art that is the in thing, you know, especially when it comes to fan arts. I mean, I'm partially a victim of that myself, I will admit. Publicity through that, because you're kind of writing off the characters, what's the word I'm trying to find? Just the character's image, basically, so you don't have to worry about how you do your designs and all that. But yeah, actually I'm running a little topic right now. But basically what you want to do, just forget about the world. Forget about the world. You know, screw what everybody else is doing and just do art for yourself. Alright, and then eventually you'll start reaching a point where you find that you're finding the love again for art. And then eventually, you will eventually then get to a place where you can see other incredible artists out there, and instead of getting incredibly jealous and demotivated, you will then start to see them from a perspective where you will then find inspiration. And then from there, you can take that inspiration further and include that to be part of your artistic experience. Alright, so getting through that, then you will eventually reach a point where you want to develop, you want to get better as an artist. Now, I tried to improve my skills over quite a few years deliberately because I got into a place where I really realized that my fundamentals were lacking and my artwork was just, I was struggling through it, the whole process was quite a struggle. I was relying on far too much reference. And in that way, just the whole experience became sort of nightmare, and I would get quite anxious and nervous before an artwork. You know, these are the kinds of things that are quite common with a lot of artists. These are things that we don't normally speak about because, you know, somebody like me who has worked with clients such as DC Comics and Bandai Namco and various other companies in the entertainment industry, I have a certain image that I want to make sure that I'm upholding, so I'm not going to show any of my weaknesses. But, you know, I'm here today to pretty much show you that as much as many of my fans will put me on a pedestal, I'm very much a human being, just like you guys, you know, I've got my own stuff to deal with. Alright, so, basically, it gets to a point where you realize, I want to do something about this. I want to make sure that I am not defeated by these fears, these struggles as an artist. And that's when you decide that you want to teach and learn, so completely wide open to learning. And then from there, that is when you want to get involved in the fundamentals. I cannot stress to each one of you artists, all of you artists in the Artist Alley, how important the fundamentals are. You know, for a while in the beginning, I didn't really pay much attention to the fundamentals. I thought studying that was very boring and all that. And so I left it. For years I left it. And yeah, that really hurt me the ass big time. But later, when, yeah, once again, I was struggling there or anything. And when it comes to studying the fundamentals, I've realized there are three very important fundamentals that I see many artists who are not getting right to start off with. The first one would be composition. That is pretty much, in my opinion, the baseline, all the other fundamentals that come after that. Then there's lighting. And now with lighting, you can also enhance your composition through that by knowing where to put your shadows, where to put your highlights in just the right places, for example. And then there's color, basically. And then you have the more secondary ones like anatomy, texture, vanishing points, and all those kinds of things. How you want to be going about your studies, because for quite a while it took me a while to figure out how to study. And eventually I came across the answer. Now this is very important for you artists, so please remember this. If you take anything away from this, take this away. Repetition is your key to improving your skills. For example, if you're trying to study a hand, you want to draw that hand 10 to 15 times over or more. Because I used to do pages and pages of different hands. And then, you know, afterwards I tried to draw hands out of my imagination. And I realized, whoa, you know, I have all these beautiful hand studies that I've done, but I'm not getting any results. Then I realized that I actually hadn't studied one of those hands properly. So yeah, repetition. You want to make sure that whatever you draw, you are repeating that over and over to a point where you are working out and you're really basically developing muscle memory, basically, when it comes to what you are trying to learn. So it's the same with any other thing in life. Repetition is the key. Alright, so that pretty much covers fundamentals. Now, that's a huge area to get into by itself, so I just want to try to keep it brief and simple because I have quite a lot to go through. Another thing that I've spoken to a lot of artists, they don't seem to be too aware of first warming up. I'd say 15, 20 minutes or so, whatever you are going to be producing, it's not really going to be so great. You know, for a while, that's what happened to me at live. Whenever I would be sketching, I'd be like, oh, it really looks bad. And then I would get one myself, because so I would think, you know, I should know better and all that. But you need to give yourself a period of 10, yeah, 15, 20 minutes to warm up first, because then you are warmed up and ready to produce the best results that you basically have to offer. Right, so yeah, warming up is very important. Right, so basically, once you've gotten through enough practice with fundamentals and you're confident enough to be showing your art around, you eventually want to reach a point where you start promoting yourself. Okay, now when it comes to the promotion, aside from just showing your friends or your family or whatever, you want to be getting your artwork on as many different art sites or art communities, social medias as you can online. Because these days, it's not just about being good enough anymore. You've got to be more than good enough. You've got to be clever about how you go about promoting yourself. So yeah, you also want to make sure that you are producing content on a regular basis as well. Because yeah, it's cool being able to produce one really amazing piece, but then, you know, because there are so many amazing artists these days, you're going to get drowned out very quickly and people are going to move on. So you want to post consistently so you are in the minds of people on a regular-ish sort of basis. So, and this is an ongoing experience, you know, this is going to be something that basically you're going to be refining and tweaking and finding better ways of promoting yourself, whether it's about the kind of content that you are showing to the world. Basically, you have your artwork across the internet that you're posting on a regular basis, you're getting people to see your art, you're getting positive comments, your confidence is growing and all that. Then you will start getting contacted for work. So before I move into that section with involves dealing with not just the industry, but just dealing with working for anybody, whether it's a single person or a small company or a huge company. Before I move into that section, do you guys have any questions at all? Alright, so the gentleman in front here just asks what websites I recommend posting your art on. I would say DeviantArt is a very good start. And then you have other sites like Behance. Then there's ArtStation. Then when it comes to social media, aside from Facebook, that's obviously one that you will eventually have to create your own page and all of that. And then, you know, when it comes to Instagram is another great one to get exposure. Instagram, there's, I have a Twitter account, so I'm not really that active there, but yeah, Twitter will get you somewhere. And then, you have accounts like Tumblr. But yeah, there are also, aside from just those that I've mentioned, there are so many different art sites, art community sites online. So if you just do Google search, the primary one, especially that I even get contacted today on a regular basis, is DeviantArt. I mean, that's a site that's been going for quite a while, and I know a lot of people have reported in certain ways, but still, that still has a huge amount of traffic. So that's a great one to start off with. And then, you know, with whatever you feel comfortable with, because it's very easy to try and keep track of so many different art accounts online that sometimes it can just get a bit too much to handle. So you want to start small at first and then just kind of build up to how you feel comfortable. But obviously, the more the better. So yeah, the more the better. Alright, so I've just been asked, is it ever too late to get into art? And I'd say no, not at all. When it comes to time and age and all of that, that makes no difference whatsoever. I know it's very easy for us to get to be convinced that it's a factor, but it's not at all. I mean, I have a grandmother who is in her 90s right now. She only started art 10 years ago, and she's creating amazing things these days. So if you're worried about, if it's never too late to basically develop your skills because you're too old or whatever, I would say the biggest important factor when it comes to age is, where is your personality at your current age? How many excuses are you making? What stories are you telling yourself about yourself on a regular basis? You see, and that's where I'd say time and age really matters, because it's very easy to tell ourselves a sort of certain story about how we see and believe about our own selves. And that in many ways can be the biggest block. And basically, I mean, all you really need to do today is basically just choose. Do I want to answer part of my life? Do I enjoy it? Do I want to do this every day? And if that's a yes, and there's a love there, no matter what your age is, you'll be able to move forward in a way where, I mean, that makes no difference to attracting clients away. Like, age makes no difference. So, yeah, it doesn't matter, man. It doesn't matter how old you are. Okay, so moving on to the next section now. Alright, so when it comes to dealing with clients, whether it's an individual person or a company, in the beginning, this is something that can get really messy and can be very frustrating. And basically, what I found is that there are certain companies and a lot of people who are wanting art that don't necessarily always know what they're after in detail. Alright, so when you get briefed, you'll normally, generally in the beginning, get briefed very roughly, and they'll kind of leave a lot open. And because you're starting out, you're not really too sure of what to expect, whatever, so you kind of go along with them. So you produce whatever sketches, artworks, whatever in the beginning, and they will be coming back to you with, you know, especially in the beginning, never-ending changes, which can get super frustrating as hell. Alright, so the only way that you can really get around dealing with clients at the beginning, no matter who they are, small or big, basically you want to make sure that you are asking them the right questions when it comes to what they are after. So, you know, if they are very brief and not giving you enough details, you want to make sure that you understand in detail what they are after in terms of design, color, style, everything you can think of. So that maybe, and also you want to ask them for references, visual references, so that you guys from a visual point of view can be on the same page. Alright, so once you have eventually worked out these sort of concepts that is being asked of you, then you can get to the point of pretty much giving your quotes for the job. Alright, this is also another tricky area, because I know a lot of artists, they get a bit nervous around the stage because they don't know how much to charge, or, you know, what's too little, what's too much, or whatever. And, you know, I'd say in the beginning, you just kind of got to start somewhere and work around there. What I do find a lot is that I'll often have people asking me what my rates are, or trying to at least get a general kind of feel for what the sort of general rates are for whatever a client is after, whether it comes to a character design, a background, just a portrait, whatever it may be. And then you can kind of work around that for what your time is worth. And, okay, another thing is that a lot of clients will have their set rates, especially the larger companies. I know with DC Comics, for example, their set rates for their covers, their standard covers, start at $500, okay? And, you know, at the time when I did my first cover for DC back in, when it was 2010, I did a Power Girl cover for them. $500 for me at the time wasn't quite enough. So I pretty much, because I kind of spoke to them about that and negotiated a little bit, they have their second higher rate, which is $715, which they pretty much pay their all their well-known artists. And yeah, so that was their set rates. But it goes a bit further than that, because I recently did a variance cover for DC Comics, and they ended up paying me $1,000 for that. So obviously, you know, that's, I feel a lot more comfortable with that. And in that situation, they actually asked me directly for what I charge, what my rates are. And, you know, it's going to vary from client to client. You know, someone just give you that's their set rate, and that's just the end of it, and even there's no negotiation room whatsoever. And, you know, in those cases, if it doesn't meet your needs, move on. Because at the same time, you need to keep on holding the level of respect for yourself as an artist, and not to try to lower yourself to try and meet the needs of any intimidating client out there. For those artists, we can easily be intimidated by these bigger companies. And again, kind of straying off a little bit here, but this is something else I want to say to you as well. Do not work for free. This is something that I've experienced, especially working locally, when it comes to ad agencies. I work for my fair share of local ad agencies here, and occasionally they will approach me to say that they are working on a pro bono project, which means that they're not earning any profits out of the job. And then they basically kind of hope and expect you to work for free because of that. But the thing that I don't really agree with that is that everybody working on that project within that company, they're still getting paid at the end of the month, so it's only fair that us artists still get paid our time. All right, so seriously, don't work for free. I know many artists will buckle under this because they don't want to scare clients away and they want to try sort of be as, word, basically just be as easy to work with as possible. But in that way, what artists are then doing, they're basically hurting the artist community, because then artists are not taken seriously, and that's where basically they feel that they can cut costs on, because artists don't have the confidence to stand up for themselves, to be able to just ask what their rates are and leave it at that. You know, recently I was asked by Upper Deck. Now, these are the guys that do the trading cards for Marvel. They were going to send me 30 sketch cards for me to sketch on, and then post it back, and then obviously they would handle it from there. And they set rates, these sketch cards, I mean, they're pretty small, normal trading card size. Their set rate was $5 a card. Alright, so that in my mind, when I first saw that, I was like, no, there's no way in hell I'm going to be, you know, settling on that rate. And I told them what my rates are, or according to what I charge for my commissions that my fans end up paying for. So it's only fair that, you know, these larger companies have the money to pay for, you know, what I'm asking for. So, you know, I asked the equivalent of what that would have been, according to my rates, was $30. And I said to them, I'm able to budge on that a bit, I can do it for them, or the lowest I can do is $20. But then, I was only willing to do 15 of the 30 cards, because obviously I'm going to be using up a lot more of my time to do the 30 and then get paid a lesser amount. And, you know, you've got to stand your ground, because I did that with them. Unfortunately, that was their set rate and that job didn't go further, but they said to me, we'd love to keep in touch for future potential work. You want to make sure that you are taking yourself seriously as an artist, so that when you are working with clients, they can see that you are a serious artist, and that basically, you're not just going to let them totally take advantage of you as an artist. Because that's something that happens so very often. Alright, so, yeah, you want to take yourself seriously first before anybody else can take you seriously. Alright, so, once that's out the way, once the quote's out the way, everyone's agreed on the job, you're happy with the quotes, you're happy with the brief, everything is clear, then basically that works from there. You'll just be, you know, conceptualizing and coming up with whatever rough ideas over the next day or so. Whatever sketches, I personally normally work on about 2 to 3 concepts that I'll present. And I'll normally focus most of my energy into one concept. And then just kind of add, you know, the other one or two as options for them, just to kind of choose from, just to give them options. And yeah, generally they always go for the one that I pay the most attention to. And once everything's signed off, they're happy with the concept for you to take further, then basically, yeah, that's you going to be spending whatever time you need to finish that job. Oh yes, also deadlines. That's another important thing. In the beginning, you want to make sure that, you know, you agreed on the deadline and that you can actually manage that time accordingly. Sometimes, depending on their deadlines, they will either throw you in the deep end and, yeah, you won't know, quite know how to manage with that. But also, as well, at the same time, if you're given a deadline that is, you can see they're in a position where it's an emergency, you can actually charge them more. Because obviously, anybody else is going to be doing an emergency job, they have their rates that cover those extra expenses, because obviously you're going to be going more out of your way for them. Alright, so once the deadline has been approved and you set yourself that, what I do personally to try and keep that, even if the deadline is pretty tight, I set myself a schedule. So every day I mark what I want to work on. And eventually once I've mapped everything out in that way, then everything becomes a lot more believable, and I can actually see that, hey, you know, what I thought was once a very tight and crazy deadline actually looks believable now for me to actually complete this on time. And yeah, so that helps quite a lot. And then what I will do throughout the whole process, from the beginning of the job to the end of the job, I will only most of the time just give them 2 updates when I feel comfortable showing them progress, just to get their feedback and just to see how they feel about the direction of where I'm taking the artwork. And generally, because I've set such a good foundation with the client, making sure that we are 100% on the same page before taking the job, this makes the process of the artwork so much easier, because we both have that on the same page. When I send them feedback, the majority of the time they are really happy with the results. And they say, okay, great, just keep on doing what you're doing, and you know, yeah, everything is running smoothly in that way. And in the end, when it comes time to finishing off the artwork, what I will then do is I will send them a low resolution JPEG of the final image. Because, oh wait, let me just go back. In the very beginning, also, along with the briefing, along with the quotes and all that, you want to make sure that your payment terms and conditions are known. The terms are, because I've ran into so many problems before when it's come to getting paid. I mean, basically, I've had clients, because I had no structure, no conditions at all on my end, I've sometimes been paid months after a job has been completed. So what you want to do to cover yourself in those instances, you want to make sure that before the job, they pay you 50% or whatever you've agreed on for the quotes, and then at the end, they pay you the remaining 50% once they've confirmed the final artwork, before you give them the high-res artwork. Because trust me, if you give them the high-res artwork and they haven't paid, then yeah, they're not really going to worry about you too much. And yeah, then you're going to pretty much be hounding them about, you know, haven't been paid yet, you know, what's happening and all that. Yeah, so you want to make sure that you have those strict terms and conditions. There are some clients that you're not able to really change those kinds of their terms of that way. Like for example, DC Comics. My first experience with them in 2010, it took them okay, no, this was a kind of a screw up on their side, and they did apologize. They sent me a whole bunch of free shit, which was pretty awesome. But basically, they took me 7 months. It took them 7 months to pay me. And, you know, that was definitely one of the longest time periods I've ever had to get paid. So, you know, in cases like that, you want to make sure that you don't put yourself through that. It's like basically going through to Quick and Pay or wherever, and, you know, going to the toilet and being like, okay, cool, now I'll pay you at the end of the month. You know, where is that ever going to happen? So, in the same way, us artists, it's only fair that we get paid up front or, you know, get payment on delivery of the artwork or whatever the case is. So in those ways, you've got to cover your own ass, just so that you can avoid all these kinds of frustrating struggles. All right, so once the artwork has been fulfilled, everyone's happy, and the payment has been made, then you send through the artwork, and everyone is happy. And yeah, that's pretty much the whole cycle of working with clients, in my experience at least. So, yeah, that's pretty much that. And okay, we have a question over here. Okay, so I'll just ask about when it comes to payments, are these payments arranged in terms of PayPal? And okay, in this, when it comes to DC Comics and clients in general, Bandai Namco, Udon Entertainment, Capcom, all of these bigger companies, they'll pretty much pay through a wire transfer. So basically, you give them all your banking details, your sort of code, your routing numbers, and all of that. And yeah, that's pretty much the way that they work. You fill out the entire form with all your details, and yeah, they take it from there. And normally with those experiences, the cases where I haven't been able to actually change their terms and conditions, they normally pay at the end of the month. The latest. They will not pay any later than the end of the month. Whilst they're going to be giving me a lot more free shit as well. Alright, so I've just been asked about what kind of art styles in terms of digital, traditional, or whatever that clients are looking for. And basically, you know, that changes from artist to artist. We all have our own ways of creating our own art. So you'll have one artist who's completely digital, and you'll have another artist who will be 100% traditional, or will be a bit of both. So you'll have someone who sketched out the artwork, and then they will color it in Photoshop. So it's really, there's no limits there. It's pretty much whatever, if they like what they see with whatever you're producing, no matter how that's created, they'll want to use it. Okay, so I've been asked, do I sometimes work on projects where they will want me to just be responsible for either the penciling or the inking or just the colors, and then basically collaborate with another artist? Now, because what I do is very much focused on creating a full artwork over just by myself, from my line art to the colors, and that is 100% me. Generally, when I get approached by clients, they're wanting what they're seeing that I'm offering. So I've never had a case where someone's just wanted pencils for me so that it can get colored by another artist. So that's just my experience at least. Yeah. Okay, cool. Well, when it comes to actually making sure I don't kind of copy or kind of come across as another artist that inspires me, like, for example, Adam Hughes, J. Scott Campbell, as well. You know, these days there are just so many artists out there that it's kind of hard to keep track of. Okay, yeah, so Sakimi Chan is definitely one of my inspirations, because, I mean, the way she does, in particular, faces and skin, she knows the fundamentals big time. And also, you know, one of my first inspirations when I was much younger was Tensuga Nomura, who's a pop dance artist. And she, you know, which he worked in Capcom Auto. And you know, in the beginning, when I was starting out, I copied their artworks quite a lot because obviously I was trying to build my own style, so they had a style that I was really liking. So copying them enough, eventually their style rubs off on you in a big way. And a lot of people would compare me to Katsuya Nomura, Shinkiro, and you know, even these days I'll get compared to Art Jones sometimes. And you know, when it comes to that, I just have to make sure that I'm aware of my fundamentals enough so that I know which certain areas that I'm pushing that's looking too much like them. Just to make sure that I'm always aware and giving my own interpretation or whatever that is. But sometimes, what I'm hoping to do is sometimes I can actually mimic certain areas of the artworks, like for example, how they might do a nose, or hey, even an ear, or certain parts of the hair, or body, whatever. You know, most people won't even realize those details. So I take small bits and pieces, and I'll kind of make it my own. And then from there, I want you to focus on their art for a while, and over time, it kind of loses that kind of feel that they have at the beginning. And then, yeah, I pretty much make it my own, and it sort of takes time. Alright, cool. Well, guys, that pretty much concludes my talk today. Once again, if any of you have any questions that you would like to ask me personally, you're welcome to come to my table right here in the front. And yeah, I'm also in print, so yeah, that's available as well. Also as well, you're welcome to contact me on my Facebook page as well if you have any questions at all, because I don't normally, the questions only come later, so yeah. Anyway guys, thank you very much for being here, for attending this. Yeah, I wish you all the best. Take care, everybody.